civilized and homebound. We welcome them once again to the sharing of our High Holy Day literature. We look forward to your full participation in our service tonight. Please take special note that wherever you see the inserted red in our prayer box, tonight we actually add those special readings, as this is Shabbat. There is much music, there is much joy, and there is also much solemnity. As you may notice, prior to lighting the Shabbat candles, lit before us is our Yisker candle. Yisker meaning remembrance or memorial, in honor and memory of all those whom we have loved and lost. It is a mitzvah during Kol Nidre and Yom Kippur that every family who has lost someone lights a candle in their home. And to help you fulfill this mitzvah, we hope that you will all take home a Yahrzeit candle, which is located in the rear of the hallway as you exit, one for every family to help you remember those who should be sitting with us tonight. Perhaps in the generations past, fill our hearts and memories. We turn now in our Matzors, page 247, stand before the open arm.
Sovereign of the universe, in awe and humility, have come to stand before you, pray for your people Israel on their behalf. Who is fit for such a task? That you are present to us whenever our voices rise in praise, that your great mercy have compassion on us and all who are gathered here this evening.
Let our congregation not falter on our account, nor weak on theirs. Guide the lips of those who lead your people in worship. Strengthen our faith and purify our thoughts. And let your love draw a veil over all our failings. So may our prayers ascend this day to the throne of your glory. Amen.
May all be seated as we continue now to light the lights of Shabbat and Yom Kippur. It is a pleasure to welcome forward to light the candles this evening, Rachel Astry and Rain Adler. Page 248. Page 251. synagogues throughout the world. The start of Kol Nidrei, the Torahs come out from the Ark. They are handed to those individuals who have guided this congregation and continue to do so in the leadership and the role of president of the congregation. And so on page 251, I would invite now to open the Ark past presidents Mary Howard and Gerald Flansbaum, who are also founding members of our congregation. And to come forward, I welcome forward Ed Adler, Lisa Drazen, Lou Friedman, Wendy Pillar, Michael Pressman, Mark Ruderman, and Sandy Wilpon. And I ask you all to rise, please.
In the sight of God and of the congregation, no matter how far some of us may have transgressed by departing from our people and our heritage, we pray as one on this night of repentance. Kol Nidrei, a whisper of wings, as promises are remembered, saint and sinner alike communes with the Most High, we are in one.
Part of all life, from this day we call me to the next, may we reach you in peace, all Israel links and vows, to turn from sin and wrongdoing, and to walk in the way of your law, the path of justice and right. Yet we know our weakness, how prone we are to fail. Help us to keep these vows made with dry hearts. We have come to seek pardon and forgiveness.
Thank you. Oh, dear.
Obligations we incur to you, O God, between this Yom Kippur and the next, be null and void should we, after honest effort, find ourselves unable to fulfill them. Then may we be absolved of them. V'nislach l'chol adat b'nei Yisrael l'ager hagar b'tocham, ki l'chol ha'am b'shragah, knowingly or not, the whole community of Israel and all who live among them have sinned. Let them be forgiven.
As in your love, you have been patient with this people from the time you led us out of Egypt to the present day. So in your great love, may you forgive your people now.
By your name,
oh.
sharing the world of our being for our being, and above all, the creation of me, who be without a shall legacy, who not only get us from me, who is a dear and a poor of me, and we should grow up again for our being of years to come. Glory to our life, the Lord, who makes us strength, and those who make heart. My dear, you will make me fly high. My dear, you will make me fly high. And I see the ocean of. You are high and high. We need you all to have a year in the last half year. Our Lord has taught you how to be a part of me. Thank you.
True and enduring are the words spoken by our prophets.
Glory to God.
first and the last. You are the strength of our life, the power that saves us. You have been the help of our people in time of trouble.
You are our refuge in all generations.
Your power was manifest when we went free out of Egypt.
And every liberation from bondage to sin.
May your law of freedom rule the hearts of all your children.
And your law of justice
to may the righteous of all nations rejoice in your love and triumph by your power.
O God, our refuge and our hope, and glorify your name and our power.
Thank you.
From this day, atonement shall be made for you to purify you. You shall be cleansed from all your sins before you turn out.
We rise for Hatzipanish.
Mir haben Gott in der Seele,
Elohim, dem Vater dein Unterbruch, war gut, als Adonai, der sei immer gut.
HaKadosh Hashem, HaKadosh, Kedushim HaKoyom, Yahaharuch HaSelah. Eternal God, let your presence be manifest to us in all your works, that reverence may fill the hearts of all your creatures. Make all your children mindful of your glory, that we may unite to do your will with perfect heart. Yours are the dominion and power, and the impress of your hand is upon all that you have made.
Grant honor to those who fear you, inspire the courage of those who wait for you, and fulfill the hope of all who trust in your name.
Hasten the day that will bring gladness to all who dwell on earth, and victory of the Spirit to those who bear witness to your truth.
Then the judge shall speak in his own, and our righteous blood and his servants sing for joy. Then shall all believe in the name, and the wicked vanish like smoke.
You alone shall reign over all your works, as it is written.
The eternal one shall reign forever. Your God is coming from generation to generation. Hallelujah.
You are holy, awesome is your name. There is no God but you.
The God of all the angels is all in righteousness. Holy God is sanctified
by righteousness. Blessed is our God, the Holy Son. We render thanks to you that you have called us to your service, to bring the knowledge of your word to the four corners of the earth.
You have called us to your servant to give faithful witness, even in suffering and deprivation.
In this solemn hour, O God, we draw near to you. May the observance of this day of atonement and Shabbat help us to remember Israel's sacred heritage. Teach us to build our lives on the abiding foundation of your law. Open our eyes to the goodness of life and its sacred opportunities for service.
O source of mercy, give us the grace to show our parents those who have been against us. When the wrongs and injustices of others wound us, may our hearts not despair of being good. May your trial, Lord, persevere, and hear our souls and destroy our trust. When we spread by trouble and sorrow, our mothers and fathers who love the honor of faith and fortitude, may we use our strength to meet adversity, our high courage and understanding well. Help us to understand your injustice and hate will not forever thank the human race, that righteousness and mercy will triumph.
Sanctify us with your mitzvot and bring us near to your service, that we may be worthy to proclaim your truth to all the world.
Sanctify us with your goodness and power, us with your salvation. Purify our hearts that we may serve you in truth. Reveal about our truth, and your word endures forever. Blessed is the Eternal One, who sanctifies the Sabbath, Israel, and the Day of Atonement. Israel.
On the top of page 267, we gratefully acknowledge that you are our creator and preserver,
the rock of our life and our protective shield. We give thanks to you for our lives which are in your hand, for our souls which are ever in your keeping, for your wondrous providence and your continuous goodness, which you so upon us day by day. Truly your mercies never fail.
Thank you.
Join together in our prayer for peace. Grant us peace, your most precious gift, and eternal source of peace.
And give us the will to proclaim its message to all the peoples of the earth. Bless our country that may always be a stronghold of peace and its advocate among the nations. May contentment reign within its borders, health and happiness within its homes. Strengthen the bonds of friendship among the inhabitants of all lands. And may the love of your name hallow every home and every heart. Jesus, O God, creator of righteousness, and the scribes in the book of life, bless you in peace. Blessed be the eternal God, the source of peace.
As we now prepare to pause for a few moments of our own silent and private meditation, offering our deepest hopes and prayers for the year ahead, I want to share with you, as I did last year, a reminder of how to stay safe in the world today. Number one, please avoid riding in automobiles because they are responsible for 20% of all fatal accidents. Number two, please do not stay at home because 17% of all accidents occur in the home. Number three, avoid walking on the streets and sidewalks because 14% of all accidents occur to pedestrians. Number four, avoid traveling by air, rail, or water because 16% of all accidents involve these forms of transportation. Of the remaining 33%, 32% of all deaths occur in the hospital. Whatever you do, stay out of the hospital. But what you will be pleased to learn that if you really want to stay alive this coming year, only 0.01% of all deaths occur in the synagogue. Therefore, please remember that logic tells us that the safest place for you to be at ever any given point in your life is the synagogue. And when we read Torah, it's even safer. The number of deaths occurring during Torah study is even too small to register. So for safety's sake, this new year, please stay alive and come to synagogue. It could save your life. We pause for a few moments of silent prayer.
Thank you.
song. He raised me, he
known as the Bedewing, Confession of Our Wrongdoings. Just a note about the word sin, which you will see repeated over and over and over again in these many hours of Yom Kippur, 26 hours to be exact, for fasting and praying. There is no word in Hebrew for sin. The word is al-chet. And you will watch us beat our breasts many times, literally, as we do indeed share with God and within ourselves all the wrongdoings that we have perhaps partaken part in as individuals or as a community. But the word al-chet is actually an archer's term. It means to miss the mark. The idea of sin is really foreign to Judaism. The fact is that all of us throughout our lives and every day of living, sometimes we hit that bullseye, and sometimes we hit the mark. Sometimes our arrows stray so far that they're nowhere near the target. Our hope on this Yom Kippur is not to apologize for sin, but to work harder, to practice more until we're able to hit that target more and more each and every day of our lives. So as we rise for this confession, let us also rise with the purpose of trying to do better in the year to come. Page 269, we rise again. Thank you.
Eternity and the dark secrets of all that live? You search the inmost chambers of the heart and probe the deep recesses of the soul. Nothing is concealed from your sight.
Now may it be your will, out of all generations,
to create all our sins,
to
acquire
all our
treasures. Our faith, Jehovah, and the forgiveness
of
our
souls.
The sin we have committed against you under the rest.
Our age of
the time of the
the sin we have committed against you by hardening our hearts.
Have made to the tongue of my death the people in shame.
The sin we have committed against you by hardening our hearts.
The fate of the
tongue
of
the Pontiff
is
the
glory
and glory.
The
sin we
have
committed against you by
the
sin we have committed against you by
the
honesty in our heart. For all these, O God of mercy, forgive us, pardon us, forgive us. We now take a few moments of our own silent prayer and meditation. Hear our voice, eternal God, have compassion upon us, and with that compassion accept our prayer. Consider our words, look into our inmost thoughts. Do not cast us away when we are old. As our strength diminishes, do not abandon us. For you, God, do we wait, and you, our God, will answer.
Amen.
Continue with the piano and that foundation.
Page 280 and rise as we open the ark and chant one of the special prayers for the high holidays.
I
The story is told of Dr. Chaim Weizmann, a chemist who became the first president of modern Israel, at a time when he was lobbying British politicians to win their support for the Zionist effort to gain a homeland. One member of the House of Lords said to him, "Why do you Jews insist on Palestine when there are so many other undeveloped countries who could live in more conveniently?" Weizmann answered, "That's like me asking you why you traveled 20 miles last Sunday to visit your mother when there are so many other ladies living on your street." This sermon is not about Israel, even though Israel is in the hearts and minds of many these days, but rather about universalism, particularism, to whom and to what we feel connected, and to whom and to what we feel obligated. We don't just visit any lady on the street, we want our mother. Life today presents a dazzling array of people, places, and events that constantly and incessantly vie for our attention, energy, time, and money. Many walk around with cell phones, pagers, and/or PDAs that make us accessible at all times and all places. We cannot escape the demands of family and friends, bosses and coworkers, our communities and our world. Emails appear on our screen at any hour of the day, voicemails record every request and petition, and media of all types compete for our consideration. Today, at least, the most solemn Jewish holiday of the year, we attempt to close out all the noise of the world to focus on who we are and what we might become. It is a chance to think about the principles that should influence our actions and the ways we can be true to ourselves and those principles. On Yom Kippur, more than any other time, we are called upon to think about who we are and how we choose in a world of endless choices. Sorting out priorities presents challenges. We know that we should answer the call from our child's school nurse rather than continue our business meeting, and that we need to respond to our boss rather than take another 30 minutes of lunch. We feel we should visit our parents and grandparents in the nursing home rather than visit the golf course or the spa. And we correctly assume that our efforts at volunteering to make meals at the local soup kitchen gives us a better sense of self-worth than spending more time at the mall. Yet, after the needs of our family, job, and community are met, it becomes more challenging to sort out who has a claim on us and who does not. The 18th century Scottish philosopher David Hume noted that our sense of empathy diminishes as we move outward from the members of our family to our neighbors, our society, and our world. Traditionally, our sense of involvement with the fate of others has been in inverse proportion to the distance separating them and us. What has changed, though, is that television and the internet have effectively abolished distance. They have brought images of suffering in far-off lands into our immediate experience. Our sense of compassion for the victims of poverty, war, and famine runs ahead of our capacity to act. Our moral sense is simultaneously activated and frustrated. We feel that something should be done, but what, how, and by whom? Although I don't like to admit it, for most hours of the day, most days of the year, I live inside a bubble. Yes, I take public transportation from the Bronx almost every day, and I ride the subway from the Bronx to Manhattan, and even though I am next to many people who do not seem to be like me in most ways, I don't truly interact with them. I spend the majority of my days with wealthy, educated, white people, most of them Jewish. That's not necessarily a bad thing. I freely chose to become a rabbi, and I love being a rabbi and being with Jews. But when I think about how sheltered and privileged this segment of the population is from the rest of the United States and the world, I do at times feel a little guilty. Most days, I live with what's called the veil of ignorance. The veil of ignorance is a concept articulated by John Rawls, a 20th century American philosopher. He posited the following thought experiment. Imagine that you are hidden behind a veil of ignorance. You haven't yet been born, and you are going to be randomly assigned to a life somewhere on Earth. You have no control over where you will be born, what your race or socioeconomic status will be, or what your level of ability or disability will be. Given that, and what you know about the distribution of wealth, talent, and opportunity in the world, would you be willing to roll the dice? You have a 1 in 6 billion chance of being born as Bill Gates, but a 1 in 6 chance of being born to a family whose income is less than $1 per day, and a 1 in 3 chance of being born to a family whose income is less than $2 a day. In today's paper, we read that in the United States, 1 out of 7 adults is below the poverty level, and living in the United States, and 1 out of 5 children in the United States is living below the poverty level. The likelihood that you'll be born into a family as socioeconomically well-off as your current family is most likely less than 1 in 20, and if John Rawls were speaking specifically to us, that number would be less than 1 in 1,000. Your unwillingness to take this gamble is a measure of how unfair or unjust you think the world is. If the world were more fair, being randomly reassigned wouldn't seem so scary. Would you take the gamble? Okay. Although I don't like to admit this either, most days I don't mind living behind a veil of ignorance. I like my gourmet coffee, I enjoy dining out in fine restaurants, and I love traveling around the world. There are so many things that I want. But at the same time, I want my principles to play out in my life in a real and not just a theoretical way. I jumped at the recent chance to be part of the first rabbinic delegation of American Jewish World Service to the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. I had the opportunity to step outside my usual bubble and to live my principles in a way that benefited people in need, not just in my chosen communities of Westchester, the west side of Manhattan, and Warren. True, I was surrounded by wealthy, educated white rabbis while on this trip, but it wasn't the typical rabbinical get-together. 11 rabbis of all branches of Judaism lived, worked, and learned together for 9 days. About 3 hours from from Cancun, we lived for 1 week in the small town of Muchukushka, sleeping on hammocks covered by mosquito nets in Spartan thatched roof huts with a heat index of almost 100 degrees every day, and no, there was no air conditioning. Members of a local farming cooperative hosted us in their homes for meals. We learned how difficult it is to make a living there, and that the majority of young men leave their families to try to make some money in the hotel industry in Cancun. While in Cancun, they perform menial labor, sometimes working up to 16 hours each day for only a few dollars. After our week in Muchukushka, we had the opportunity to see the living conditions of those who try to find a way to live in Cancun. Humble shacks, many with no electricity or even running water, house families anxious about where their next meals would come from. Leaving their family and community behind to subsist in this way was heartbreaking to witness. This was definitely not the bubble that I live in. Back in Muchukushka, we saw that incredible progress and possibility is available through the help of donors and devoted professionals. It was astonishing to see how a family's life and how an entire community could be changed with so little investment. HAWS partners with El Hombre Sobre la Tierra, or Human Beings Over the Earth. This organization works with Mayans to develop their skills and resources to make money. HST established a cooperative of 54 people from the village, and their lives have improved tremendously. They learned how to cultivate a variety of fruits and vegetables and to raise animals. Our group transported concrete blocks for them to build fish tanks for a fish farm. More than anything, the cooperative gives them hope for the future. It was truly amazing to learn that an entire family's life can be transformed for as little as $300. The veil of ignorance was lifted, and it's hard for me to see things in the same light as I did before the trip. I wrote about my experience in the Temple Harshal online newsletter last month, and I hope that you will take a few minutes to read more about it when you return home. I also hope that you'll consider making a generous donation to American Jewish World Service, and more information can be found in the article online. One of the phrases that we learned from Ruth Messenger, president of American Jewish World Service, was that we cannot afford ourselves the luxury of being overwhelmed. Yes, so many people around the world need our help. And yes, we could use all of our resources until there was nothing left for us. But at the same time, we cannot afford ourselves the luxury of being overwhelmed, because then we can't do anything. I think that our sages knew this concept even in Talmudic times, when they wrote, Lo alecha halacha ligmor, lo alecha ligmor. It is not up to you to finish the task, but neither are you free to abstain from it. It's just another Jewish way of saying that we cannot allow ourselves the luxury of being overwhelmed. I haven't yet changed my life entirely, but I am more conscious of the choices I make and how they affect others, even people in faraway places. One of the important lessons that we learned on the trip was that even though some things might seem like a bargain or a good deal for us, an article of clothing, a vacation, a service done to us or for us, especially in another country, someone is paying the price for it. A worker may be toiling for countless hours for very little pay. Someone might have had to leave their family or community, and or other sacrifices take place for me to enjoy the item or service at a low cost. Even giving a few extra dollars to hotel chambermaids, for example, can significantly improve their take-home wages and make a meaningful difference in their lives, as can many small other things. Relatively insignificant amounts to us can benefit those who need it significantly. Speaking of others who need our help, later on this summer, I read Three Cups of Tea by Greg Mortensen and David Oliver Relland. This inspirational story recounts how a mountaineer who failed to summit K2 and almost dies upon his return is brought back to health by a small alpine community in Corfu, Pakistan. Mortensen promises to repay them by building their first school for their children. The book describes the Herculean efforts of Mortensen over a period of years and his ultimate success in building schools for poor, mostly Muslim, Pakistani, and Afghani children. The book was so inspirational, I sent the donation to Mortensen's Central Asia Institute. It might seem a little unusual for a rabbi supporting Muslim, Pakistani, and Afghani children, but the book makes it clear that educating children can have a profound and lasting impact on individuals and our world. If I want to contribute to making peace in our world, I am obligated to them as well as to my Mexican friends, the Muchacushka. It's so challenging to figure out whom to support when giving our dollars and efforts to those who need it. In Talmudic times, Rabbi Joseph taught that there are priorities in loaning money. Not surprisingly, because of the context of his life 2,000 years ago, he teaches that if the choice lies between a Jew and a non-Jew, a Jew has preference, the poor or the rich, the poor takes precedence, that your relatives or other people, poor people from your town, your relatives come first, the poor of your city and the poor of another town, the poor of your city come first. In our world today, however, the distinctions can become a little more blurry. Rabbi Joseph's hierarchy doesn't necessarily apply to modern times. We need to support Jews and non-Jews, relatives and non-relatives, the poor of central New Jersey and the poor of faraway lands. Yes, the choices are difficult because we cannot support all, but remember, lo alecha hamlecha ligmor, lo alecha ligmor. It is not up to you to finish the task, but neither are you free to abstain from it. Of course, we are responsible for our children, our parents, our families, and Judaism teaches us that all Jews are responsible for one another. Yes, we also have to support those in need, wherever they may be. Finally, we must realize that we are responsible to ourselves, too, in a way that connects us to others. Today is about tshuva, turning. The world outside can only heal when there has been a healing within. There can only be peace among others when there is peace in every heart. And there can only be respect for others when respect is afforded to self. Finally, there will only be honor for others when each of us becomes true to our own highest self. We can best create peace in our hearts when we go beyond ourselves to help others. There's a reason that the most mentioned mitzvah in the Torah is the commandment to love the stranger as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. If this commandment came easily to us, we wouldn't need to hear it so many times. This commandment reminds us of the pain one feels as an outsider, a stranger. To us, the stranger can be a Mayan in Mexico, a Muslim girl in Pakistan, or anyone who is not a member of one of our groups, be it Jewish, American, white, whatever. Yom Kippur pushes us out of our comfort zones to be better people. While the essence of Yom Kippur is to search our inmost self by being true to ourselves, this only succeeds when our introspection is combined with reaching out to others. Our tradition clearly reminds us that this time of reflection is to go beyond the inwardly focused nature of Yom Kippur and to reach out to others. Tomorrow's Haftarah from the book of Isaiah states, "Is this the fast that I seek? A day for people to starve their bodies? Do you call that a fast? No, this is the fast I desire, to unlock the fetters of wickedness, to let the oppressed go free, to share your bread with the hungry, and you see the naked to clothe them, and not ignore your own kin." Our prayers won't be worth much if they do not propel us to look beyond ourselves. Although Hillel taught that we must stick up for ourselves, since no one else will, by saying, "Imin ani limidli," if I am not for myself, who will be for me? He immediately followed this principle with the words, "Ul sha'ani la'atzmi ma'ani," that if I'm only for myself, what am I? We cannot only support ourselves, but must reach out to all who need our help. Hillel concludes, "V'im lo achshav eimatai," if not now, when? Today is the best time to get started on our obligations to ourselves and to others. We have many choices in our world, and many compete for our involvement and resources. May the hours we observe of this Yom Kippur remind us of our priorities to care for those around us. We need to love the people that are closest to us and those who are not like us at all. Our families must feel our care and concern, and so must those we don't even know personally. This sacred day, may we take responsibility for our actions, because when we become aware of the needs of the world, we become responsible for them too. Lo alecha amcha ligmor, lo alecha ligmor. We can start now to make our world a better place from the inside out. Ken Yehi Ratzon. May this be God's will. Amen.
We now return to our prayer books, page 282. For Alenu, it is a pleasure to call forward Audrey and Stephen Sherman together with Debbie and Barry Scheinholz to open the Ark. I would ask you all to rise, please.
He said that the words of Alenu on page 282 are ever so slightly different than the way we normally chant.
Standing. As we continue with the following reading, birth is a beginning and death a destination, and life is a journey from childhood to maturity and youth to age, from innocence to awareness and ignorance to knowing, from foolishness to discretion and then perhaps to wisdom, from weakness to strength or strength to weakness and often back again. From health to sickness and back we pray to health again. From offense to forgiveness, from loneliness to love, from joy to gratitude, from pain to compassion, from grief to understanding, from fear to faith, from defeat to defeat to defeat, until looking backward and ahead, we see that victory lies at not some high place along the way, but in having made the journey stage by stage, a sacred pilgrimage. Birth is a beginning and death a destination, and life is a journey, a sacred pilgrimage to life everlasting. And we remember those now who have made the sacred pilgrimage. We remember those who have died on this season in years past, as on this Shabbat we commemorate the Yahrzeits of Gladys Blythe, Emmanuel Fan, Joseph Gans, Dr. Norbert Goldenberg, Herbert L. Green, Kenneth Wieroff, Harry Milden, Lawrence Morris, Harold Perlin, and Sidney Pillar. And we remember those who have been taken from us in recent days, as we remember Carol Grabelski, Irving Handelsman, and Daniel Meyerson. We remember all those in our hearts and our memories, and we say Kaddish is a community for all those who have no one left to remember them. And as Americans, we remember all those who give their lives so that we may live in freedom. Together on page 284, we recite the Kaddish. We pray that the sword of peace will send peace to all who mourn and comfort to all who are bereaved among us, as we all say.
Amen.
You may be seated. I would like to take just a moment to remind all of us gathered here today on the importance of fasting the entire day of Yom Kippur until the blowing of the shofar tomorrow evening. But please remember you are to do so only if you are healthy enough to do so. Fasting on Yom Kippur is meant for the healthy, 13 years of age and older. Those who are sick, who take medication, according to Jewish law, are actually forbidden to fast. If one is not certain whether you are healthy or not, or permit yourself, please err on the side of health. And please be sure to feed your body and your soul when you come here. You can try again next year if you would like, but only if according to the laws and traditions of our faith. The decision to fast or not is left to the individual. It is not left up to a physician or anyone else to make that determination. If there is ever any doubt, please, again, I remind you, Judaism places emphasis on health and life before almost any other mitzvah that you will find in our Torah. So for those who will be fasting, may it be meaningful and may it be easy. And for those who need to eat, please do so just out of our sight. Also, just a few other announcements about our Yom Kippur commemoration. As you leave this evening, we would ask that you please leave your mafzors, your prayer books, on your seat so they are ready for our early morning service, which will begin at 9 a.m. This will be followed by our late service at 12:15, a musical interlude between 3 p.m. and 4 p.m., at which time, for the first time, the ark will remain open for the entire hour, so that anyone who would like can personally ascend the bima and offer prayers and blessings on their behalf. The afternoon service will continue at 4 p.m. and will conclude together with Yisker and Nehillah at 6:30 with the blowing of the shofar, Havdalah, and of course, a little nash. If you have not picked up your grocery bags, there is still plenty of time to do so. A reminder that our fast is one that we are choosing. But as you heard from Rabbi Gerstein, there are millions in this world that don't have the luxury of choosing to fast. Their fast is imposed because they are hungry. We can help, as he has asked us to do tonight, by bringing back a full bag of groceries that will be distributed to the hungry and needy in our own community. Please do not forget to take a Yahrzeit candle home. There is no blessing when one lights a Yahrzeit candle. If there is no one in your immediate family that you are remembering, then please take a candle and light it for all those millions of Jews whose deaths were not recorded and who have no one left to remember them. And finally, a very special thank you to the choir, the musicians, to Nancy Hyman-Cohen, and to Cantor Berman for lifting our spirits and filling our sanctuary with the sound of glorious music and prayer. On behalf of all of us here on the Bima, our President Ed Adler, our Board of Trustees, and our entire staff, we take this opportunity to wish you a sweet and fulfilling Shana Tova and Shabbat Shalom. We will conclude with a closing song.
Adon Olam, page 75.
Strong, enough hope to keep us happy, enough failure to keep us humble, enough success to keep us eager, enough friends to give us comfort, enough wealth to help others, enough enthusiasm to look forward, enough faith to banish depression, enough determination to make each and every day better than yesterday. And let us all say, Shabbat shalom.